was released that American adults in the workforce left behind 705 million days of unused vacation in 2017. And for the third year in a row, upwards to 54% of Americans were not taking the time off granted by them. So this says to me that there is something embedded in our identity as a nation that conflicts with our identity as Christians. We, and I am definitely guilty of this too, work longer than we say we will, we overdo it, and when the time comes for a day off, when in most cases we have 2 days off, we don't take it, we forego it to squeeze out a little more office time or more hours. There are many reasons for this, not the least of which is a need for more income. But it still poses a dilemma, which is at the heart of those of us who hold our faith very dear. What do we do when outside forces intercede on our piety? That is the dilemma posed by Mark in today's gospel reading, which occurs in other gospels on several occasions. The recurring theme in this and each of those, Jesus doing things he ought not to do in the synagogue, and in many cases on the Sabbath. The Deuteronomy lesson today points us back to the Decalogue, the Ten Commandments. It also points us back to the story of creation in Genesis. We are charged as children of God to remember the Sabbath and to keep it holy. This notion from the Ten Commandments is fundamental to the identity of the Hebrew culture from which the Old Testament sprung. It is retained in Christianity, and it is fundamental to our understanding of God. In its poetic beauty, Genesis 1 describes the mighty acts of creation in 6 days. And then Genesis 2 begins appropriately enough with the words, "And on the seventh day, God finished the work he had done, and he rested on the seventh day from all the work he had done." The act of rest, the seeds of what would become the Sabbath by the time we get to Exodus, is two-pronged. It is to give us, people, everything, a break. It is also to celebrate and keep holy all that God has done. So children are punished, if we can call it that, by being put in timeout. I think as I get older, I'm starting to appreciate timeout more and more. Children are put in timeout when they're overextended or overstimulated. But have we as adults ever considered our own timeout as being an actual reward? Sabbath is to take a timeout and behold anew what the Almighty can do, and to say, it is good, it is very good. The Hebrews rightly assigned the seventh day, the last day of the week, as the Sabbath. That's where the word Saturday emanates from. Christians adopted that. We transfigured or transposed it to the seventh day in a strange way, which is also the first day. So it's like the Beatles song, 8 days a week, I guess. The last is first. We honor the Sabbath on Sunday. At least that was before lacrosse and soccer and all those other things got in the way. The point, though, has always been clear. None of us, not a single one of us, is any more powerful than God. If God can rest and behold the work of creation, then so must we. It's not a suggestion, it's a commandment. Okay, so enter Jesus, who, it must be stated again, is a child of Israel, knows his scriptures backwards and forwards, and follows the law. But Jesus is also in a dual role as Son of God, and therefore he can cast everything we understand from that perspective. The Sabbath is a break, but the Sabbath is to be holy. Sabbath belongs to God. So when Jesus finds himself doing Sabbath-y things, like teaching and reading scripture in the synagogue, he is technically in violation of the rules. And the moment he lifts a finger to heal the man with the withered hand in the sanctuary is the ultimate breaking of the rules. There's no hesitation, though, on Jesus' part, if you notice. No debating, no waffling, no feeling of, it's Saturday, I can't do it today. None of that. He just acts. He just acts. The man is healed, and yet the pot is stirred. The Pharisees are aghast. How can you do this? In Luke's gospel, in a similar situation, he says, I am the Lord of the Sabbath. Here in Mark, he prefaces the healing with, the Sabbath was made for humankind, not the other way around. It's essentially to say, when the leaders of the synagogue try to smooth over the waters and clarify when and where you should do work, Jesus is saying, look, I am the darn Sabbath. As is clear in all of the Gospels, Jesus appears to be a walking contradiction. But in reality, he is a redefinition. The Sabbath is a holy day, not just a day of rest. It is a day devoted to prayer, devoted to good works, devoted to quiet, devoted to all of this, whatever the day of the week it may be. And by God, if somebody needs healing or prayer or assistance or anything of the like, then that's something that person can do to make this day even holier. And imagine, if you will, you lived your whole life being taught that on Sundays you don't work, you don't lift a finger, and then along comes Jesus and says, no, that's not quite what God meant by the Sabbath. God meant make it a holy day. Don't become prisoners of a law that cannot take into account real human experience and godly prioritizing. When we move to the fonts for this baptism, we will walk through some of the things we need to be reminded of in our baptismal covenant. And those are prescriptive, and I also want to prescribe a couple of other things about the Sabbath for you to take home. Three R's. None of which stands for rules, by the way. This is bigger than rules. The three R's of Sabbath are rest, remembrance, renewal. Rest. If God can take a time out, why can't you? Remembrance. Remember the Sabbath. Remember it as a gift from God and an invitation to behold all the wonders God has done in creation. And renewal. Use it as a time out. Use it as an invitation to refresh, to recharge, and to make changes for the better in your life. Make it a day where you can heal the withered hand somehow. Pray, listen, be still, do good, and Sabbath. Amen.